एवरीवन, आई एम आर्या शेडगे, योर टुडेज होस्ट. होप यू ऑल आर डूइंग वेल एंड स्टेइंग सेफ. टुडेज आईटी इंडस्ट्री इज ड्रिवन बाय डाटा. एवरी डे पेटाबाइट्स ऑफ डाटा गेट जनरेटेड ऑल ओवर द ग्लोब. कैप्चरिंग रियल टाइम डाटा इज अ क्रूशियल टास्क फॉर द मोस्ट ऑफ द इंडस्ट्रीज. कस्टमर लॉयल्टी सर्विस प्रोवाइडर इंडस्ट्रीज यूज दिस रियल टाइम डाटा टू एंगेज देयर कस्टमर्स. Considering the importance of data science in our career, VIIT Alumni Association has invited Mr. Pavan Kumar Barlota to deliver a webinar on the same. We are enlightened to tell you that Mr. Pavan Kumar has excelled in the field of data analytics and data visualization for over 13 years. He is currently working in Wipro, which is located in Fremont, California. Without taking too much of your time, I request Mr. Pavan Kumar to enlighten us with the current cutting-edge technology and future trends in his field.
So thank you all for giving me your time and joining this presentation. Today we are going to talk about the science and the future of data visualization. What really data visualization is, and how are we going to use that data visualization in our day-to-day life? Basically, we are going to answer three questions. One is, what is the data visualization? How basically we do the data visualization? What is really a science behind it? How do the companies or the product or the startups they are coming up with really design their system for the data visualization? And then towards the end, we will talk about where it is heading to. All these disruptive startups that is coming in market, what are they really bringing in for us? So with that, let's get started and just discuss what is this data visualization, right? Data visualization is visual and interactive exploration of data of any size, type, and origin, which basically means it has no religion. The data can come from anywhere around the world. To your surprise, you might know that there are 2.5 quintillion of data generated each day. 2.5 quintillion is basically 2.5 thousand trillion of data each day. So with so much of data that is coming around from, let's say, Internet of Things, right? Every sensor is generating the data. The AR, VR, every images are being converted into the data and then being stored in the large volumes. Every social media tweet, the Facebook comment, even the Google searches, all those are contributing to the data generation. Every message that you type in, every call that you make, every time you call a Google Home or the Siri or the Alexa creates the data. So there are numerous channels today, right? Every service that you go online and try and work on the services, it creates the data. So there are numerous ways that the data is being created. And it is so disruptive, and the volume and velocity that is being created is tremendous. So now you have plenty of data around you. How do you make use of that data is the next question, right? And when I say, how do you make use of that data is basically how it is benefiting your business, how it is benefiting the society in general, the community in general, right? And the humanity in general. So now the only way that huge chunk of data that we have, we can make use of is to find out some of the patterns, some of the trends, some predictions around it, some correlation between the data, some sentiments in the social media feeds and Twitter posts and things like that. So unless you find out the meaning inside the data, you will not be able to use it, right? There are about 80% of the organizations whose executives, claim that they are not using their data to the core. Their data is basically getting wasted, right? And how do you make use of that data? The only way forward and the way that was before is the data visualization. Unless you visualize and make it clear that what pattern, trend, or correlation or relationship you're trying to find out, or what are you going to predict from the data, data is of no use to you. You might build the data lakes, you might build the different database systems, the cloud databases, but it just helping you to hold the data. Then you might use a lot of data science tools and testing statistics on the top of it, but it is of no use unless you find out a result out of you unless you answer a question, unless you show off something that, you know, infer you to take a decision, right? And data visualization is the philosophy, the tool that helps us to do that. So with that background, let's move ahead and see how the data visualization and our brain is, you know, connected to each other. It is being said that, right, the picture is worth 1,000 words. What does that basically mean is our brain is able to grasp the pictures very quickly than the text that we read. And it is in our subconscious mind that 90% of decision or conclusion that our brain takes is from the memory that it has stored, the, you know, plethora of images, the trillions of bytes of images in our memory, right? So I just tried to pull some stats around how our brain and this data visualization really go hand in hand. And that is the science basically for this data visualization, right? All the startups and the new companies and even the existing vendors, they basically look for the data science, right? And then they try to find out how that data is being explored and visualized. But when they do that, right, and when they show you the probable charts and graphs and dashboard that you can use, every time they go back and relate it to the brain, how your brain process that data, right? So let's see some of the stats. If you see here, right, 90% of information transferred to the brain is visual. The another stat is 60K, right? We process images 60K times faster than the text. The another stat is that half of our brain is dedicated to visual function, right? And the 99% involves subconscious processing of visual. So our 99% of perception, right? We build a perception about something, right? I have not seen, let's say, IIT Bombay, but just because of the gossip that I had with my friend, I would visualize how that might be looking. You know, the professor there might be, you know, with big hairs, looking like a scientist or stuff. So 99% of our perception comes from the visuals. With that, there are two statisticians, one statistician and one mathematician, and I really like their quote. The Edward Tuttle is an American statistician, and what he says basically is, in a perfect data visualization, there are no rules, no guidelines, no template, no standard technologies, no style books. You must simply do whatever it takes your brain to interpret and understand quickly. Simple and sober, and it should convey the message that you are planning to give, right? The John Turkey, another American mathematician, says that the greatest value of data visualization is when it forces to notice what we never expected to see, right? Something which we never thought of. We don't know the value of the data. We don't realize the value of our data that we have in our organization. And if our visualization is showing you those or forcing you to notice that wealth that is hidden under the data, that's the best visualization that we have. So that's the correlation between the brain and visualization, right? Data visualization. Now, I just want all of you to try reading this text, you know. Just try reading this. Okay. Now, if you notice, right, only the first and last letters in this word is correct. All other letters are, you know, interchanged. But the way our brain works is that it finds the patterns. It reads the word, then individual letters. It goes beyond the normal viewing and go back to our memory and try to find out. Maybe we have read similar words in the past, and so it quickly conclude that what he is reading now. So even if your letters are interchanged, misplaced, just because the start and end are in their place, our brain can still read this, the whole paragraph. And that's amazing, right? You can completely read it from start to end if you really give it time. Maybe initially it was like, oh, what it is, but if I just give you, like, you have 1 minute or 30 seconds and you need to read it, you will be able to read this. So that's the, you know, the science of brain. How does it interpret the data? How does it interpret the visualization? The other example, you might have seen this many a times. Some of you might see this as a blue, some of you might see it as a white. It basically because what kind of color composition your brain holds, right? And whether you are a left brain person or a right brain person, which part of your brain overtake on the other part is basically determines how you color code, right? Some of the blind people might just understand the two scales, and some of who has a good eyes might have the range of scale, right? So basically brain has something to say in the whole data visualization, and that is basically a science why everybody goes beyond understanding this. Now can you guys try to locate the brush in the picture that I'm going to flash? You need to locate the toothbrush, right? I'm going to flash a picture and try to find out where is the toothbrush in this picture. Okay. Now, by now, most of you have noticed the small green brush lying down there, right, on the table. And now many of you might have realized that there is another big blue brush, which is relatively much bigger in size than the reality, right? So in this example, how this our brain have worked is basically, we might have seen, oh, there is a shoe down there, there is another bottle around it. And what our brain did is we tried to relate relate the size of the bottle with the brush. And we know for sure that brush must be smaller or the size of these bottles. And we started looking around with that that memory that we had in our brain. Never to realize that we know for fact that brush can't be this big. Who will use this big brush? So what this infers basically that our brain is biased many places. And it plays a very critical role in identifying objects, patterns, and stuff like that. So when you design certain visualization, you need to really understand these preemptive attributes and the visualization science, right? That's the point that we're trying to make it here. Now, one second. For some reason, I see this pop up and I don't see the heading of my screen. Okay. So anyways, so this insist, right, this is basically the statistician, another statistician. He is very old and he has developed a lot of models in the history. And this is one of his model where he is trying to prove that the grouping of data, right, to certain level can give you certain stats, which is far beyond than the reality. And what does that mean is, let's say if I give you this this table and I tell you, can you find the stats in this data? For example, let's say assume the groups are regions and then X and Y are basically your sales and profit. And you want to find the relationship between sales and profit. So just with this table, it is very difficult, right? I mean, it will take some time for you to find out the mean, the max, the deviations, the correlation, right? But if I give you this data to a statistician and ask him, can you find certain stats out of this table for me? And he would do it happily. And this is what he will get. What he has found in that data is the mean of all the X values is 9, mean of all the Y values is 7.5, and correlation, sample variance, linear line, regression line, everything is same for all the data. So what does that mean is for each group here, you see this group A, group B, group C, group D, for each group, the kind of stats that he found is almost same. But if you really look at the data is different in each group, right? So what does this tell us? The data is different, but if I try and find the stats, if I give it to a data scientist and ask him to form a model, the basic stats that he will find is this. It's like everything is same. But now if you use a visualization, you will find that the stats might tell the same story, but the story is different. The group A, the distribution of data is a little bit diverse. In group B, it's like curve shape. In group C, I see that there is a horizontal line one with one outlier. In group D, I see that there is one vertical line of formation with one outlier. So what does this tell us? Some of the time, right, the statistical model and data science by their own cannot tell you what really the data is trying to tell you the story. You definitely need the data visualization. And data visualization basically tells you another story beyond the statistical models, and that is the power of data visualization. Now, if you take it to the next layer, there was another two statisticians, Justice and George, and they tried to write a Python code and tried to use the same XY standard deviation factors and draw a different graphs out of it. And you'll be amazed, every chart that you see on the left hand side has the same X mean, Y mean, standard deviation correlation values. But if you see these visuals, you'll be easily able to say that, oh, this is a dinosaur image, this is a star, this is a circle, right? Different graphs, and they all tell you the different story. So statisticians alone will not be able to tell you the story. You definitely need a data visualization on the top of it. And that's the power of data visualization. Now, going to the next, what are preemptive attributes? I told you, right, our brain and subconscious mind understand certain characteristics, and based on that, it determines what he is seeing basically. Are there any outliers? Are there any highs and lows and relations, right? So what are these preemptive attributes? And I'll explain it towards the end and you'll be clear what basically preemptive attribute means. But before that, let's go here and just find out. I'm gonna flash another screenshot and you need to find how many nines do you see in this picture? The digit 9. It's a little bit difficult for your brain, right? What you basically need to do is to go to each digit and find out whether it is a number digit 9 or not, go row by row, glance all the data, and then come to a conclusion. But now, what if I make it a little bit easier for you just by popping up those nines with color? So what does this mean is your brain understand the color quite well, and it differentiate the data just based on the color. And that color is preemptive attribute. So there are many such preemptive attributes that your brain recognizes. Another example is, now let's say if I take this data further and I try to show you the same data in the chart. What this chart is telling basically to you is there are 13 number of nines in the data that I had just flashed before. It also tells relative to others, how's your relative frequency? Here you have only 13 nines, but number of six were more. And these lines basically will definitely tell you, let's say if I don't have all these numbers on the bar and I just have 21 here, I will still able to relatively make out what could be this number. Okay, so this is 21, this is half. So this could be around, 13, 14, 15, around that number. So which means just by looking at the graph without the data, I will still be able to conclude something. And that's the preemptive attributes. So like this, we have so many preemptive attributes. The color is one, the length is another one, and there are like so many. And we definitely need to understand all of these preemptive attributes if you really want to build a good data visualization dashboards. Now, when I flash this screen to you, you might have seen that in this diagram, orientation of this one is not correct. This looks a little bit taller than all others. This is wider than the others. This is the bigger than the others. This doesn't belong here. This shape is different. This is not a curvy. This looks straight. This gives more details. This has a color. This is out of the this position is not at the right place. So what does this tell you is, even if I don't put the data on any of this graph, just by looking at this graph, you can infer something. You can come to a certain conclusion. And that's the power of your preemptive attributes. when you visualize something, right, if you use these preemptive attributes properly, then your dashboards, your visualization will be great. And this is all part of your science behind the data visualization. Unless you understand this, you might build a data visualization which looks good, but they might not be useful. Okay, so let's move on now. With this background, which type of chart or graph is right for me, right? I got a sense of science behind the data visualization and I want to build the graphs now. How do I determine which graphs are good for me? How do I build the data visualization? So before we go there, let's hop in and see some of the graphs, right? Graphs and charts. So this is bar chart. Bar chart basically tells you a categorical data in much readable format, right? This basically is telling you how are the sales for a company is increasing over the period of time. Every year, 12, 13, 14, 15, and then in each year, every quarter, how are my overall sales increasing over the period of time? And that's the story basically bar chart tells. Now, if you want to make bar chart a little more interesting, you can use the colors to show another dimension. You can use the size, right? You can change the orientation from horizontal to vertical, right? And so many more things, right? Now see the line graph. Line graph basically tells you, it connects the discrete points and then form continuous evolution. It could be the time range that over the period of time, how are my numbers looking? How are my finances looking? How is the annual return of these two companies in this graph, right? How's the annual return of this, let's say Amazon and Google over the period of time in the stocks? That is it. That is what it is showing off here. It is always good that you use the line graph with the bar graph, right? In this scenario, if you see the line graph is the one on the top and this is the bar graph which complements it. Now, when you add bar graph, what it is giving you, it's giving you another dimension of measure, right? It's telling you basically every day, how much of volume trading was done at that day. And then relatively it shows you that, okay, how are my returns for two companies? So line charts always will tell you the distribution over the period of time and in a continuous fashion. And you can use those measures, those dimension differently. It need not to be just the time frame. You can also use, let's say, if I'm trying to find how the person in a certain region grows over the period of time. Now, one person might get taller quicker, the another might be smaller. So one might be 2.3, 2.4 each day. He might be growing up by centimeters, another one 2 centimeters. So there is no standard discrete points there, right? It's like continuous. So I might say that, okay, from height 1 to 6 feet, that is the distribution that I have. And in that distribution, I can just show the line graphs. So that is basically a line graph. Now, let's go to the pie chart. Pie chart are not the good charts that you should be using. It is very vague and give you less information. It is only give you a proportion of a whole, right? How much percent of my technology sales looks compared to all other sales in the organization, a very basic information. They are but always good if you use them with another chart. Like in this diagram, if you see, it is being used with a map. And what this basically telling you that in certain regions, how are the foreign investment being happening? So pie charts tell you the part of the whole kind of scenario, but you should always use it with the another charts, right? Then the map. Map are widely used these days because all the organizations are global and they want to basically find out how their business is doing across the geographies. And maps basically render the data very well. If you have the code, like PIN codes, the status, state names, the city names, the country names, the regions, you have latitude, longitude values, which can drop the maps. So maps are basically used when you want to show relative information in the location. For example, in this graph, if you see, right, it is showing sales by geography, right, in the USA. And the color tells you the intensity of the sale, right? The darker is the more sales in that region. and so forth. So maps are always useful when you want to show the global, right, local location wise details, maybe sales, the profits, the number of average height in each country and stuff like that. The another one is the scatter plot. Scatter plot basically tells you the relationship between two variables, right? The relationship could be positive or negative. What does that mean is, if I change one variable, the another one will have an effect on it. Or there could be no effect at all. For example, if I increase the discount, will it give me more sales? Right? They are dependent. But if I increase the discount, will it add more employees to my organization? It doesn't make any sense, right? So scattered plot basically tells you the correlationship between two variables. And it also sometimes helps you to cluster the data. Right? I might form the clusters and give them a name. And then I can also find out the outliers. Like in this scenario, if you see, there are some outliers which are outside the data. So outliers are basically a data point in your graph or in your chart, which is not normal. It might be good data point, it might be bad data point, but it's not normal. So it always gives you an opportunity to find out corner case scenarios in your company, right? And scatter plots are the good charts that you should be using to find out the outliers. Now the bubble chart. Bubble chart we basically use when you have three or more dimension to check, right? And now here in this case, if you see, what we are trying to show is the products and how the sales of those products are related to each other. And as soon as I look at this, I know that the copier, right? Where's my mouse? Okay, here. So this copier has more sales than anybody else. And the color shows the profit. Though I have copier, sales of copier much more than any other product type, the phone and chair has more profit, right? So it basically gives you the idea of the big data in a second, right? You can cluster the data, or you can divide the data and then form clusters and then infer some values out of it, right? Infer some information out of it. Here in this case, we are checking sales and profit by colors and the size of it. So that is bubble chart for you. And then we have a bullet chart. This is also another good chart. It's a variation of the bar chart. But what this basically tells you is, when you have a goal, right? This was my goal, and how am I doing against that goal? That is when you use the bullet chart. Here, these black vertical lines are basically goals set. And then these are your actual numbers. So what it tells you that above target and below target, right? Everything that is blue is like, I have achieved the target. Everything which is purple, I have not achieved the target. In what sense? In each month, for each type of product category, how are my sales looking? Did they meet the target or did they not? So it's very easy and quick glance. Otherwise, you will have to use metrics and stuff and so many filters and find out the data. This just putting up one goal bar on the bar chart gives you concrete information. So that is the bullet chart. Now, there are many other charts, and I don't want to go into the details because of the time. But there are Gantt charts which show you the schedule, right? You have a histogram which tells the relative information. You have highlight table. This tells you the density. What density means basically is the darker the color that has the more value, thus lighter the color has the less value. It could be sales, it could be profit, it could be the ratios, anything. And then we have tree map. Tree map basically tells you how is your cluster looking in comparison to another cluster. And then you again divide that cluster. Basically in this scenario, if you see, each color is one region. And in each region, each country is divided again. So it forms a tree kind of a structure, right? It starts branches out, and each branch has one region. So that kind of data you can use tree map. Then you have box plots. Basically, it tells you the distribution, how the distribution is. And if I have a range that to look at, and I can definitely use this chart. And the last one is candlestick chart. This is a variation of the previous chart, basically used in the stock market. It tells you the highs and lows and how at each point the highs and lows were varying. So that is a candlestick chart. Now, with so much of information so far, we have checked in the science, how the science has been used for data visualization. We have checked different charts. Now, the next question that might have come to you is, with so many charts around, if I get a data set, how do I choose the chart? Which chart is right for me? How do I determine which chart to start with at least? So to answer that, these diagrams tell you, give you an initial glimpse, and this is a very powerful diagram if you ask me. What you need to do is, before you determine which chart you need to use, is you need to find out what you want to show. What would you like to show? Am I showing a relationship, or am I showing a composition? Am I showing distribution of data over the period of time relative to each other in 2D or 3D? Or I am just comparing sales versus profit, one data point versus another data point. And once you understand that, and you know basically what you are planning to plot one of these four, you basically understand the strategy that you are going to use, and you understand the data, what basically that data tells, then the next step is that you, if it is a relationship between two variables, I will just go and check, okay, I can use a scattered plot because it tells me the relationship between two attributes. If it is three attributes, I will go and use the bubble chart right down there, right? If it is just a comparison, I would use, you know, the bar chart. It compares by category different values, right? I might, if it is over the period of time, I would go and use it, the line chart, like for continuous values. So this diagram is very good diagram if you just start building the charts, right? Understand the chart, find out what you are trying to do out of the data. Comparison, distribution, composition, or relationship. And once you know that, use some of these basic charts to start with. And as you explore the data and visualization, you will know that, oh, I need to supplement this chart with another chart to give the next level of details, the drill downs, right? And another interesting point that you might see here is scattered chart is there in relationship also, and it is also there in the distribution. So what does that mean is one chart might help you solve multiple purposes, but in what context I'm using a scattered plot matters the most, right? So you need to determine who are your stakeholders, what are they asking for, what are their questions, and then go from there. Okay, hope I'm clear. I don't want to go through all other charts, but let's pause it here and digest the information that I have spoken so far. Science, right? The preemptive attributes, the type of graphs, and how to choose the right chart for me to start with. Okay, let's hop into the next session, second part of the session. What makes the best data visualization? Now you know which graph or chart to choose from, right? Now, the next thing is, how do I make it best? Everybody can do a good data visualization with just 1 week of basically training, but it takes a lot of time to go from good to best. And that comes with a thorough understanding of data visualization principles. Now, what makes the best data visualization? Okay. So look at this diagram and it will guide you and tell you some of the places that where you should hop in and get more understanding before you start using the dashboards, right? The first thing is, how do I choose my chart? And we discussed that. So that will help you identify best data visualization. Am I to use one chart against another chart, and will it solve my purpose? The second one is, who is your audience? Right, and what is the purpose? You should ask who and why questions, right? If it is an executive level presentation, only high level summary with the drill down capability is good enough. Second level drill down. If it is a departmental manager who want to look at your data visualization dashboards, then he might be more interested in his department data than the company data. So you need to change your visualization to that level. The same data might be looked at differently by the marketing person and the finance person. So you need to think about that also. And then third is technologies and tools. Am I to use Tableau, Quick, ThoughtSpot, Power BI, Oracle BI, there are a plethora of tools in the market, right? So which tool is best for me? Some of the tools have AI, ML, and next level of capabilities, right? Some of the tools are good at developing a statistical model. Some of the good are best for prediction kind of visualization. So you need to choose which tool is good for your work, basically, your analysis, your exploration. And then fourth one is preemptive attributes. We spoke about these attributes, right? You need to definitely make use of these attributes if you want your visualization to be perfect and quickly digested by your stakeholders. And the last one is, how's your brain taking it up, right? You build a visualization, give a glance and see that, how is it looking? Take the feedbacks, improve it again. You also need to understand that when we look at the screen, right, our first focus goes to the leftmost side of the screen. And that's how we are built, right? 95% of people look at the leftmost corner of the screen first, and then they traverse to the right, then they come back to the left. The rightmost corner is the last one that we see, which means we should put most important information in your dashboard to the left, right? The upper left corner of your screen. So this kind of science you need to understand when you put the data visualization dashboards together. Now, you got how to make the best visualization, right? I will choose the chart, I will know the audience, tools used, preemptive measures are taken care. I have also used the science, a very good chart has been come up, but your chart will not tell you the story unless your data has a story in it, right? So very important part of your data visualization is, does my data have enough information in it? And this is the next segment, right? Is my data categorical, right? Does it tells it by region, the department? Is it categorical? And do I have a cluster of data? The another one is ordinal. Is there a sequence that I will get this data first and only the second level of data will come and they have a relationship, right? Is it qualitative data? Does it tell me something, right? Does it have enough information in it? Then also whether it is a structured data or semi-structured data or unstructured data. Until now, we only used to deal with, not until now, probably a decade ago, we only used to deal with the structured data. Most of our query languages used to be structured query languages. Now, the semi-structured data has become a new norm. MongoDB and other databases have come up, and there are a lot of tools and technology which evolved around it. Now, the semi-structured data is mainstream. Tomorrow, the future will be that unstructured data will be mainstream. You will have enough computation power to deal with the 2.5 quintillion data that we have spoken about before, right? So you need to understand your data also to some level before you actually start building the visualization. And that's what we are trying to tell here, right? There are three different types of data in three different formats, and you need to understand that data before you actually start building the visualization. Now, with that, let's go and see where we are heading to in the visualization world, right? So future of data visualization, with my knowledge and the experience that I have, is I feel the augmented analytics is the next big thing that is coming up. What does that mean is, basically, if you see the Apple dashboard, windshield dashboards, where in your car you have that windshield, right? You can see on there how much is your battery life left, what is the traffic looking like, right? And another few graphs and details. So that is a kind of a visualization for you to take a decision while you drive. So augmented reality. And the another part of it, it's not just showing the visuals on the screen. It also basically capturing the visuals and then converting that into the data. Reverse logistics. When I drive the car, I have like 100 sensors around it. You know, another 100 cameras. Each camera is capturing the pictures and giving me a huge data. Each picture is being converted into the data. And then we are building a story out of it to say that, oh, I am on the road. This object looks like a human. That object looks like a store because I captured the the picture of the human and interpreted it with whatever pictures that I have in the database and concluded that, oh, there is a man there, let's talk. So all this automated car, right? All the augmented analytics automation using ML and AI basically are leading us to the another level of visualizations. It's not just that what you see only on the windshield. The future will be that you don't need a projector. My watch will just, I will just tap and it will show me the visualizations on the wall. I will just, you know, pinch and I will get the visualization on my data. So that is the next level of visualizations I see that is going to happen. Another thing which is going to happen is today, my business users, stakeholders, they need the visualization. So in typical company, what happens is you will have the designers, the SMEs of the tool who will build the dashboard as per the requirement and show it to the executives and take their guidance. So it might be just informative, exploratory, or decision-making kind of an dashboards or drill-down dashboards. But where we are heading tomorrow is I don't even need the designers. If I have the data in my database, it should tell me the story. And ThoughtSpot is one such product which is going towards that point. And what that product basically does is I have the database, I collected the data from everywhere and I created a lake, let's say, what I'm gonna do is in the search box, I will just type there. Can you give me a bar chart for profit versus sales? It will show me. Can you tell me how is the average race percent across the world for, let's say, Hindus, Muslims, or certain race, right? It will just give you the graphs there. You don't even have to build a graph. And it will also give you the drill down capabilities to second and third level. So executive need not to wait for designers to build a dashboard for 1 month, 2 months. He would just type a question and he will get a graph. And that's the next thing that is going to happen. And ThoughtSpot is one such product. There are many startups which are going towards this, but they are one of the first, right? The other one is unique applications. Right. Earlier, we only will focus on the commercial applications because there is a value. Your investment will get paid off, right? But now there are many more. Like you might have seen that black hole image, right? One of the scientist girl, she wrote a program and she found that how actually the black hole looks. So what she really did is she collected tremendous amount of data from the sky and then built a small visualization which basically tells you the how the black hole looks. So that is the visualization, right? The another one is how are different sensors in our brain react to different situations, different tastes, different incidents. How do you show that? That visualization of the brain sensors is another unique application. A data-driven life, right? Now you see that you open a HDFC or whatever bank account that you have, it will also tell you in which category you are spending, how much you are spending, how does it relate to previous months and so on, right? Even the government on their sites now, they started giving you the information in the graphical charts and, you know, infographics. So data-driven life is happening. So that is the future. Everything is going to go visual because we can capture and process visuals quicker. The third one is same structure is going to be mainstream. I already spoke about it, right? All the cloud-based data warehouses are already, you know, supporting semi-structured data fluently. And they're going to do it for the unstructured data tomorrow because the kind of power that they need and the performance that they need to process unstructured data, which is in like trillions of gigabytes, is improving every day. So that is the future. The fourth one is live. I don't want to wait till tomorrow to get the data and, you know, talk about it, right? Live data is basically, if I have to give you the examples or like Google Maps, I don't wait to see if there is a traffic ahead. All the sensor satellite images, and then it converts and you see a very nice map, which tells you if there is a traffic or not, there is an accident on the road or not, where is the police cars and stuff like that. The another example is the weather forecast. you can't take a picture of a weather, but the lot of sensors that generate the data around, you use the data and then you create an animation kind of a visualization, which basically tells you where the rain is going to fall, where is, when is this volcano going to erupt, right? And things like that. So live visualization is the future also, right? They want to know that they want to know the trend right now as it is happening. They don't want to wait it tomorrow. As soon as, let's say, Tesla CEO tweets that he's going to sell all his property on the Twitter, people just start thinking Tesla is going to go down. So sentiment analysis kicks in, a lot of data, how many feeds, Facebook and stuff, everywhere, what people are talking about Tesla. And then you quickly generate a chart of a sentiment analysis. And based on that, a lot of investors take a decision. Am I to sell my investment in Tesla right now or tomorrow, or should I wait? So they want the data and visualization live right there. They cannot be waiting for 2 days. By then the market will already explode and the results will be out, right? So live visualization is tomorrow. And the creativity, the last one, it is very important. So much of data, so much of tools, plethora of visualization tools, but am I telling the story correctly, creatively, and very simple that others can digest? So the simplest and the best data visualization will win the hearts, not the complex and a lot of animation. Now, you might have seen some of my slides. It is over animation, right? And I did some of the slides purposefully just to show that it sometimes distracts you. Now, this slide might look simple, right, with some animation into it, some visuals into it to attract, but the previous slide was a little overdone. So what does that mean is if you overdo, your core values go beside. So the future is that with simplicity, how creative you become to show the data, right? That's the future. Now, these are all links and resources that I have used. And I can provide you more if you want to. Thank you all. Thank you so much for your time. I was rushing a little bit because there was a lot of content to cover. But if you have any questions, feel free to ask those questions and I'll answer them.
Great. That was a pretty extensive session, I'd say, and a very good intro into the whole subject. Thank you so much for that. Audience, if we can now, if you have any questions, you can start putting them in the Q&A. No questions at the moment. Are there any questions? You can use the Q&A button to ask questions. Okay, we are getting the questions in now. So the first question is from Kamal Kundra. How to choose right data visualization tool?
See, as I said, right, it depends on what question you are trying to answer, right? What story you are trying to tell. If you really want to just look and build a statistical model and just for that purpose, you are exploring a tool, the SAS is a good tool. But if you want to give the analytic power to the end user and make it like, you know, self-service kind of visualizations, then Tableau is a good tool. If you want your executives to have basically a typing kind of a graph development where they don't want to wait for others, then ThoughtSpot is the future, right? There you can just type in and it will generate the, like a Google, right? You just go on Google and search something, you can just go and search for the graphs, and if you have it in the, your data, then it will generate the graph. So it really depends on your purpose. You should choose it wisely though.
I think this is also a similar question. Viraj is asking, sir, the presentation was excellent. I want to know the tool which you used for presentation.
It's a PowerPoint presentation.
Dr. Lab Singh is asking, where is the dividing line between data science and brain science?
See, brain is one such an entity, right? Brain science, you can, you know, vision it like the part of data science. Data science is just an understanding of, it's very vague. You cannot basically define what data science is, but what it does basically is it takes any data and try to find out meaning out of it, try to find out trends, patterns, exploration, relationship, correlation, and stuff like that. Now, if you take an example of brain and work on that data alone, that's a brain science, right? Data science is very generic, any data, not just the brain data. Brain science is just brain sensitive information. Like many people will get the brain stroke, right? How do I predict that, let's say the current ratio is about 1.5% of the US generation gets the brain stroke at the age of 60. How do I predict what that percent will be for next 1-2 years? You can use that in that information and try to find it out in data as your brain science. I'm not a word called brain science, but it basically uses data science to find out the results around brain. I would call that as a brain science.
Okay. Mansi is asking, what skills should we learn?
Good question. Actually, if you really want to make a career and you're passionate about data science, I would say that you start from base. Don't go on Tableau tool and just learn the Tableau. Then you will become a Tableau developer without, you know, proper science understanding of the data visualization. I would recommend that you understand first how our brain processes the information. And that takes about, you know, 2 to 3 months of good amount of time for you to understand. And then you understand different chart types. You understand different data analytics algorithms, right? Because those algorithms and those methods are basically going to drive how you are going to plot the visualization. And then finally, you go on actually presenting the data visualization. Then you can use any tool like Tableau, Qlik, you know, Power BI from Microsoft, any tool. But if you are in hurry to get a job, then I think it makes sense that you just learn one tool and say that, oh, I'm Tableau developer or Tableau admin or architect. Yeah, it depends what you're trying to pursue.
I think this next question is on a similar line. It's from Burhanuddin. So what should be the starting point of anyone who wants to make a career in BI or data visualization?
You first need the determination that you really want to do it, because many a times what happens is just because everyone is going in certain fields, we go and try to do it, right? Everybody is doing a Coursera learnings, we go and do it without really understanding what those courses are. We just want to finish and put it on LinkedIn for the others. But if you have really determined that you want to do it, I think you should spend good amount of time to understand the science behind data visualization, then go to data analytics algorithms and how the data science really works, not in detail, but certain level. And then you go and try and visualize the data in the different tools.
Vishlesh is asking, sir, is Python data visualization is used in companies?
Yeah, they do actually. And if you see, most of the data scientists would do that, right? Because it requires a lot of coding and I cannot give that to the end user, as I said, right? If it is a self-service data visualization, then you cannot use Python. My end users will not know Python. But if you are a data scientist, you are building a model and part of that, you are exploring the data, right? You got a chunk of data. Now you clusterized it. Now your data makes some sense. Now you took one cluster and try to explore the data within that, right? So there you use the visualization. How do I cluster it, right? I take full data, dump it, and find the outliers, patterns, trends, and then discard some of the data, use some of them for testing purpose, some of them for, you know, training your bots or methods. That is how you go about it, right?
All right. The next question is from Navya Maricharla. Where are the application of data visualization apart from sales and marketing?
It's everywhere, as I said, right? It's everywhere. I will tell you one thing today. Now you go out of this session, right, webinar, and just look around. Whatever you see around is all data visualization. How much of text that you really read when you walk around, right? You just see the pictures and try to understand it. You see the movies, you see the video text messages. Half of the good morning messages that we get on WhatsApp is all visual. So it's about 90% of all is visualization. Now, this data visualization is very generic concept, right? If you are talking about data visualization only in commercial fields and you relate it to only companies, then that is a separate story. Data visualization can also be like this way, or let's say our alumni, they find how many of webinars happened in certain categories, and then they drill it down to find out, okay, what was the response from the students, how many of them are working in which regions, right, like the guest lectures, and then can they find out the areas where the lectures were not conducted, are there any specific topics that we should be looking at next. So data visualization can be just everywhere. I mean, you just explore whatever you have and then find out something new through the visuals.
Okay, Sunil is asking how to improve our data science skills and excel in it. Also, Sunil has another question, which is he's interested in doing business. How much will it help for business or in startup businesses?
See, let me tell you one thing. If you understand some of the stats, right, and if you are ready to ask certain questions to the data that you see, your life in general will improve. Whether you are doing a business, whether you are household person, or you are a financial guy, or you are an IT guy, it doesn't matter. The moment you understand how do you read the data and what that data is trying to tell, and if it is not telling you the story, if you are ready to ask the question, it will help you. If you understand the data visualization, if you start your own company, you can build some of the data. You want to find out where are the prospective customers nowadays, who are your competitors, how are they doing, and how are you doing against them. Where do you procure the cheapest material from? How do you manage your supply chain? Who all are doing in the market? You cannot be reading books on all these, right? You just need a graphics which will tell you quickly. So yeah, it will help. Definitely it will help.
So Dr. Lab Singh is asking, is it not that data science has some limitations?
I don't know in what context he's asking it, what limitations. See, data science has a specific purpose to achieve, right? It can only do certain things. For example, there is, even in MI and AL, right, there is a man loop, or it is called something, which basically means that machine just can't answer this question. We need a man to look at it, right? That's the end part of it. So, yeah, there are always limitations to all the technologies, but we are growing over the period of time, right? If you say that there are limitations, it will be something next coming up in the future.
Kamal Kundra is asking, user interface and look and feel in Python data visualization through matplotlib is not that great. In this scenario, will it be better to use Python for data analytics and export data to Tableau for data visualization? He also has a add-on question to that. Do we use other tools other than Power BI for business intelligence?
Yeah, as I said, right, you use Tableau, you use Qlik, you use ThoughtSpot, you use, Snowflake has inbuilt. Oracle BI is another tool. Even the SAP provides the BI tool. So there are a lot of tools in the market that are coming up.
It looks like this is our last question. It's from Jyoti. Which is the best tool to go for our daily visualization of our business or some general purpose?
If you don't have money, the Excel is the best tool. If you have money, I would say you can go for the Tableau.
Okay. Looks like we have one more question from Sunil. Taking data science course in Coursera and other online course, is it helpful?
See, knowledge, wherever it comes from, is good. It is just that, do you have enough time to explore that knowledge, right? If you want to learn quickly, then videos are a great way to start. But videos give you just the context and, you know, the infrastructure around it, just the architect, right? The framework, basically. But if you want to really go in deep, you will have to do a lot of research. You will have to read books. You will have to try and do things by yourself. That kills a lot of time. So, to start, Coursera and any other platform, wherever you can get the quick start, is good. But if you really want to make a career, you will have to spend time reading books, you know, doing hands-on and stuff like that.
I think Sunil has an add-on question for that. Recommend any online courses where to learn, as well as recommend any books for data science.
I would say that if you really want to start, you said data science or data visualization. If
data
you just
science.
Want to do Okay, data science. For data science, I don't know if I can recommend, because every book that I have read had a certain, the idea in my mind that what I'm planning to get out of this book. But yeah, I think you can go through the Sam Hopkins University's course. I have gone half of it, and I feel that the information that they were talking about, basically, I already knew. So I just wanted to venture elsewhere. But if somebody who is just starting up, I think they give you a good start.
And similarly, in terms of books for data visualization, this is from Sunil again.
Tableau has a lot of books, and you can go to their site and find out in their resources area. They have good books. The only problem in those books are that they tied back to the Tableau product, right? Every exclusion that they give. But that should be okay as long as they clear our, the theory and basics. I can share some of those links in an email after the webinars.
Okay, great. Dr. Lab Singh is saying we could not find a solution to COVID pandemic. I think data science has failed us, isn't it?
Oh yeah, I think I forgot to mention that in the future of data science, I had mentioned that, right? How do we proactively predict the pandemic like this and the amount of impact that it is going to build over a period of time, like let's say every day? That is something that was missing in the current infrastructure. And in future, definitely data science is going to help do that. And data visualization in particular is going to tell you the trend and, patterns. Good point.
All right. We are over time already. So I will not take any last questions. I just have one last. It's more of a comment. Kamal Kundra is saying, thanks a lot for the brilliant presentation on BI and data visualization. All right. Sure, with that, thank you so much. It was a great session and a great Q&A. I'd like to invite Subhash sir now to give the closing note.
Thank you, Mr. Pawan. Such a wonderful session to the participants. And I'm very much thankful on the behalf of AIT Alumni Association for giving a time for this session. And also, I would like to thank to all the participants who attended all these sessions. And lastly, I would like to thank to the Huawei team for giving a technical support for this, organizing the wonderful session. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you all for joining in and giving your time to listen to me. I just feel that it was, I just hope that it was helpful for all of you. If you have any questions, my email ID is there. You can just send me your question, and as and when possible, I will definitely respond to it. You can also connect to me on LinkedIn and ask questions there. I can answer them. Thank you so much.
Awesome. With that, we shall now end the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you all. Bye-bye.